He has not spoken at all about the substance of this comment. So we'll see if that changes after that meeting on Capitol Hill. But it's sort of a pattern here. The president often refuses, in fact, almost always refuses to apologize for something, digs in his heels, and blames it on someone else. In this case, the leaks and the fake news media, in his word. But interesting, as he was walking through the hallway there with Senator Mitch McConnell, he too has been at odds with Senator McCain over the years. He visited Senator McCain over the weekend and released a statement yesterday saying the country has nothing but respect for him. So, you know, given everything else that's going on, this is one subject that I'm told will be discussed in that luncheon today, Wolf.
Yeah, one of several subjects, and we're awaiting some members who will emerge from behind closed doors, and we'll get the very latest on that. Jeff Zeleny, thanks to you. Let's go to Gaza right now. Another day of violence there, and as well as on the West Bank. The protests resumed after funerals were held for some of the 60 Palestinians killed in protests over the moving of the U.S. Embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. The deadliest day, by the way, that Gaza has seen in some 4 years. Meanwhile, the United Nations Security Council held an emergency meeting to discuss the situation. The U.S. ambassador to the U.N., Nikki Haley, says the embassy move is not to blame for the violence.
As our president said when he announced the decision in December, the location of our embassy has no bearing on the specific boundaries of Israeli sovereignty in Jerusalem or the resolution of contested borders. It has no bearing on Jerusalem's holy sites. It does not prejudge whatever the parties might negotiate in a peace agreement. It does not undermine the prospects for peace in any way. And yet, for some, this is supposedly a cause for violence. But let's remember that the Hamas terrorist organization has been inciting violence for years, long before the United States decided to move our embassy.
Let's go to our senior international correspondent, Ben Wiedemann. He's joining us from Gaza right now. Ben, you spent a lot of time covering this story in the region. First of all, have you seen any reaction to the United States officially publicly blaming Hamas for the deaths of the Palestinian protesters?
No, we have not so far, Wolf. I think many people here, whether they're with Hamas or against Hamas or favor these protests or oppose them, many feel that the United States long ago took the side of Israel, and therefore this statement about Hamas, I don't think really has as much weight here in Gaza, where we saw today smaller demonstrations than certainly yesterday. We've gotten one report from Palestinian medical sources of one person killed by gunfire, a few wounded, but certainly nothing compared to the more than 60 killed in yesterday's demonstrations. And of course, now we're trying to understand if there's going to be more such demonstrations. There are none publicly planned or announced at the moment. This may be now that the ceremony to inaugurate the American embassy in Jerusalem has passed, now that today, the 70th anniversary of Nakba Day, the day of the catastrophe where Palestinians
Thank you. Once again, the UN ambassador, Nikki Haley, also saying today that recognizing Jerusalem as the capital of Israel makes peace, in her words, more achievable. Let's bring in retired Rear Admiral John Kirby, our CNN military and diplomatic analyst. We also have CNN political analyst April Ryan and Shannon Pettypiece, White House reporter for Bloomberg News. You know, John, you were the spokesman over the State Department during the Obama administration, spokesman over the Pentagon as well. What do you make of the way the U.S. government, the State Department, the White House, the U.S. ambassador to the U.N. have now officially responded to all the violence we saw yesterday?
Well, they're not wrong in saying that Hamas is responsible here. This is a classic Hamas playbook, no question about that. And They're also right to reaffirm the fact that Israel has a right to defend itself. It's a tough neighborhood. They have every reason to want to be vigilant and to defend their citizens. The question isn't that. The question really is, how do you do it in such a way that doesn't fuel the Hamas narrative? We know Hamas likes to hide behind civilians. We know that they like to help incite violence and cause civilian casualties, to blame it all on Israel. So how does the United States and Israel do this in a way and advocate a way that
and didn't even urge restraint on the part of the Israelis?
I can assure you, Wolf, having been at the podium at the State Department during that time frame, we did condemn is too strong a word, but we did urge restraint by Israeli forces against targets inside Gaza, and we got criticism for that, but we did, there was some urging of it, and there was certainly a lot of back channel communications with the Israelis about how to do this in a more restrained, more discreet, more precise way. But those are tough conversations to have, particularly with somebody who's a close ally like Israel.
I just want to point out that while this was going on, Shannon, there was a celebration at the new U.S. Embassy in Jerusalem, and there were a lot of distinguished guests there as well, including Ivanka Trump. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you saw the front page, the cover of the New York Daily News today. There it is, Daddy's Little Ghoul, G-H-O-U-L, Daddy's Little Ghoul, 55 slaughtered in Gaza, but Ivanka all smiles at Jerusalem Embassy unveil. That's the headline in the Daily News in New York. You think the White House should be concerned about the optics of all of this?
I mean, the optics do nothing to help relieve these tensions. What you're talking about, I mean, the goal should be here to relieve tensions. It should be to prevent violence. If you can, as you were saying, through the back channels, pick up the phone to your allies and say, let's take the temperature down, come on here. If you can, maybe make this less of a big celebration, maybe take the temperature down on the celebratory nature of it. All of these things that could be done in a more subtle way. But, I mean, this administration, and they are a year and a half in, so you can say some of these things, lessons maybe they should have learned or should have more appreciation to. But I think they are maybe also things in foreign policy that are hard to learn, and you only learn about through these sort of tough moments.
You want to make a point?
Yeah, Wolf, the optics are terrible, but the stakes are very high, as we all know. But really, the here and now should have happened months ago when they talked about the unveiling and talked about the U.S. Embassy in Jerusalem. And the issue is, from many of my sources in the intelligence community, they said, what should have happened? They should have also said something for the Palestinians. They should have said, we'll be willing to work with you on this or that, or give you something. There was nothing given, so that one side feels neglected. And that has been what I've been hearing. So it could have happened a long time ago, even as this new embassy was placed in Jerusalem. There could have been something to kind of quell the upset.
Right, you knew it was going to be a flash.
Nothing received from the Israelis either. And we gave them, we moved the embassy there and really didn't get anything in return from the Israelis, much less giving anything to the Palestinians. Right. The timing is also quizzical, Wolf. Mm-hmm. I mean, I understand the desire to do this around the 70th anniversary. I get that, and that's obviously to be something commemorated there.
The 70th anniversary of Israel's independence.
Of the independence, yes, thank you. I get that, but they had to also know that these protests are not just about the embassy. They are about that anniversary, very much so. And so it doesn't seem like this had to happen right when it did.
Right, and not to mention the Iran deal, too, just coming days
right
after
the,
pulling
right
out
on the heels
Iran
of the
deal.
Iran
so,
deal.
Yeah. I mean, right, tensions are already high, and then you throw something on it even more.
The stakes are so high at this moment,
Let's shift gears, talk about Senator McCain and the refusal by the White House to publicly apologize for what that aide said. You had this exchange yesterday at the White House briefing. Let me play it.
Okay. Where does decency and morality come into play in the workplace? I mean, she still has a job. She made that statement about an American hero. No matter what the political feelings are about him, he was broken and bruised overseas for the freedoms of this country. And to say those things, I mean.
Again, that's an internal matter and has been addressed internally. Yes.
What was your reaction when you got that statement from the Deputy White House Press Secretary?
Well, I was shocked, actually, because prior administrations would admonish or there would be some serious repercussions for someone, a lower level staffer, to go out and say something like that about someone. And it wasn't even out, it was inside. It was in the inner circle. But for it to leak out, there would be some repercussions. We don't know the repercussions. She still has her job. And I mean, Senator John McCain, it's not about politics, it's not about party. This is a man who is in the military, who is broken, battered, I mean, military family. You know, broken, battered, bruised for this nation, for our freedoms, and then for a staffer to say that, and for someone, a whistleblower, I'm not gonna say it's a leaker, a whistleblower to say this, because whoever leaked it knew it was wrong, wanted people to know. I was shocked, because I understand the dynamics and the nuances of White Houses covering four now. So I was kind of shocked and taken aback.
I want you to listen to what two Republican senators, Marco Rubio and Susan Collins, said about this whole uproar over a lack of a public apology involving Senator McCain. Listen to this.
I find them to be offensive and I think more indicative of what our politics has become, so angry and bitter. And I mean, they're just things you don't say and shouldn't say. And it's unfortunate that if it was said. And if it was said, someone should say they don't agree with it.
The best way for this to be put to rest, and it should have happened immediately, would have been for the White House to issue a public apology to the entire McCain family. I think it would be helpful if the president made clear that those kinds of comments are not acceptable, rather than criticizing the leaker.
So, Shannon, what do you think? Are they going to finally publicly apologize? Because I'm sure the president is getting a little earful during this closed-door meeting with the Republican senators right now.
I mean, they haven't apologized about anything yet. I mean, I can't think of any. I mean, from day one of the campaign, I remember people inside the campaign telling me when the president, then the candidate Trump, made those remarks about Mexicans being murderers and rapists. And, you know, he was told just apologize, walk it back. He didn't. And he saw there was a groundswell of support of people who liked that he didn't back down, that he stood by what he was saying. And that's been his operating mode ever since then. Charlottesville, there was no apology after that. There was a conscious decision. They could have come out. Sarah could have come out to the podium. Raj could have come out to the podium the other day and apologize and ended this. There has been a conscious decision not to. I don't see that changing now. And really, for the White House, I mean, they're getting into a fight with, John McCain, who's someone that there is no love lost between him and President Trump.
But a man who is dying, though, that is, right. who's fighting for his life, brain cancer, and he even said because of that strained relationship, he doesn't want him at his funeral. I mean, this.
And to
it's
your
different.
Point, in yeah. any other White House, if someone disrespected yeah. not only a war hero and someone who's dying, but a senator, a congressman,
a man
sitting
who
congressman,
ran for president,
right? Anyone, any member of Congress who would be criticized like that by a staffer, that staffer would no longer work there in past yeah. White
yeah.
Houses.
All right. Well, John McCain deserves only the best. He
yes.
is a war hero,
yes.
and all of us are wishing him
yes.
only the best. All right, guys, thanks very much. Coming up, as President Trump vows to save a Chinese telecom from U.S. sanctions, a top U.S. intelligence chief sounding the alarm on the security threat the company poses to Americans. Plus, sucked halfway out of the plane at 30,000 feet. It's just the latest terrifying example of airline windows malfunctioning mid-flight. There are new details. President Trump may let a Chinese company accused of violating sanctions against North Korea and Iran off the hook. The U.S. banned smartphone maker ZTE from buying parts from American companies for 7 years. But over the weekend, the president surprisingly tweeted this, quote, President Xi of China and I are working together to give massive Chinese phone company ZTE a way to get back into business fast. Too many jobs in China lost. Commerce Department has been instructed to get it done, close quote. Democratic Congressman John Garamendi of California is with us. He's been studying this issue now for quite a while. What's your, I was surprised by the reversal from the president. He's anxious now to save jobs in China. What was your reaction?
Make China great again? Is that what this is all about? This makes no sense at all. This company is a very serious problem in several respects. First of all, it's breaking the sanctions against North Korea, Iran, Sudan, a couple of other countries. So it is a bad player out there cheating all along the way. Secondly, there is reason to believe, serious reason to believe, that their phones, smartphones, and other devices are an espionage device.
Oh, now, what do you mean by an espionage device?
I mean that the devices that they're selling are now banned should be banned on military bases and military personnel enlisted in civilian that have them have to get rid of them. U.S. military, exactly. Have to get rid of them because it was evidence that the Chinese can use their devices to gather information from our military or from anybody else, from that matter.
There was that moment when all the U.S. intelligence chiefs were testifying before the Senate, and Senator Tom Cotton asked them to raise their hands if they would ever use this kind of equipment from ZTE. Nobody raised their hands. They were asked if they should raise their hands. If their constituents should buy this kind of equipment from ZTE, nobody raised their hands. So it's clearly the U.S. intelligence community's concern. So that raises the question, why is the president anxious now to lift the sanctions and let the jobs flow to ZTE?
Well, some people says it has to do with trade negotiations. I think it may have a lot to do with $500 million that the Chinese government invested in a project in which the Trump Organization is deeply involved in Indonesia. There's a new project going in, some sort of a theme park, Trump Organization, the hotel, the golf courses, condominiums, all the rest, just got $500 million for that development. Not directly to Trump, but most definitely to the benefit of the Trump Organization.
Well, we do know that Chinese state enterprises will provide $500 million to help develop this project, this Trump Organization project in Indonesia. The president had said earlier that he wasn't going to allow the Trump Organization, the business part of the president, to have foreign dealings, but clearly this is a major foreign dealing.
Oh, my. One more lie? One more lie out of this man? I mean, there is no way you can tell where the truth is with this gentleman.
So you, just to be precise, Congressman, so you're saying this decision by the president to tweet about lifting the sanctions against ZTE may have been the result of the $500 million loan to this Trump Organization business in Indonesia?
Isn't it curious? Isn't it curious that the tweet comes out and then within a day or two, we get an announcement that $500 million is going to an organization in which the Trump enterprises clearly benefit. They benefit with a hotel, they benefit with a golf course, they benefit with condominiums. Is there something curious about
this? Is Congress investigating this, as far as you know?
The Republican Congress investigating Trump? You got to be kidding. That doesn't happen. But this is clearly something that, in my view, is contrary to the U.S. Constitution, which is absolutely clear about emoluments. It says, Article 1, Section 9, no one in the employment of the government, including the president and members of Congress, can take something beneficial from a foreign government, king or prince.
The deputy White House press secretary, Raj Shah, was asked about this $500 million loan to this Trump Organization deal in Indonesia yesterday. He said, go talk to the Trump Organization. He didn't want to discuss it from the White House. The other argument I've heard, I'm anxious to get your response, yeah, Congressman, is that maybe the president is trying to improve relations with China and lift the sanctions on ZTE in order to get them more involved in setting the stage in a positive way for the summit he's going to have June 12th in Singapore with Kim Jong-un.
Well, we know this. We know that ZTE is a company, a major company, owned in various ways by the Chinese government. Kind of a hidden, but nonetheless, it's there. We know that that company was doing business with North Korea, that they were contrary to the American sanctions. Is there some sort of a deal here that's in the background that the president is giving a big, big prize to the Chinese government in exchange for their help? Perhaps. But there's many, many other things involved here that really concern me.
Because China President Xi does have some influence over North Korea.
Oh, absolutely.
So
there's
to
no
improve
doubt.
U.S. relations with China, that could be beneficial.
Well, let them make that argument. Let the White House, let the president say, oh, no, this deal, this $500 million, which directly benefits the president, has nothing to do with it. We've not heard them say anything about the North Korea thing yet. Maybe there's something there. Maybe there's something about trade negotiations back and forth. But we do know this. We do know that this company is a bad actor. We do know that this company has broken American law, not just recently, but in the past. We also know that this company, their equipment can be used for espionage.
We know that the national security community here, the intelligence community,
absolutely,
is deeply concerned about ZTE.
And in the National Defense Authorization Act, which is coming up on the floor soon, we'll see if the Republicans put forth an amendment to honor the president's commitment to Xi about removing ZTE.
You're a key member of the Armed Services Committee.
We're going to take it up.
As we know. All right, Congressman, as usual, thanks very much. Lots of unanswered questions that deserve to have some answers right now.
We need to get to the bottom of it.
Yep. All right, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Coming up, a terror in the sky, how a co-pilot of a major Chinese airline got sucked halfway out of the cockpit, yet survived. Plus, new questions surrounding the health of the First Lady, Melania Trump, as she remains in the hospital after undergoing... hanging out of the plane at 30,000 feet. That was the fate of a co-pilot on a Chinese airliner who was sucked halfway out of the cockpit when the windshield blew off. In the end, he suffered only a few scratches and a sprained wrist. The Sichuan Airlines plane was 80 minutes into the flight to Tibet when the windshield simply came off. The pilot was able to control the aircraft and make a smooth emergency landing. Joining us now from London, our aviation correspondent, Richard Quest. Richard, every plane goes through a series of mechanical checks and inspections, but does anyone really regularly check the windshield integrity and the seals? We've seen a few problems of this lately.
Absolutely. In fact, you check the windshield more than you check the rest of the plane's windows, because the windshield, the cockpit windshield, is an extremely complicated piece of equipment. It has multiple layers, it has heating, it has defogging devices, it has filters on it for the light. So the windshield itself is very important, it's crucial, and it is regularly checked. But, Wolf, it is also bearing the brunt of the plane's forces as it goes through the air at over 500 miles an hour. So cracks in plane windshields are not uncommon. However, mostly it's a crack and you land safely. In this case, of course, something far more serious took place and could have been catastrophic. By the way, Wolf, it's not the first time this has happened. A British Airways pilot nearly got sucked out once when a windshield cracked and exploded and had to be held in by the captain until they landed safely.
Yeah, pretty awful situation. I know they're going to take closer looks at this down the road. Let's turn to another issue, an aviation issue. It's been 4 years, as you know, since Malaysia Airlines Flight 370 disappeared. Now there's a new report out of Australia. Experts there are saying they believe it was possibly suicide by the pilot. It's certainly not the first time we've heard this theory. You wrote a whole book about this whole issue, the vanishing of flight MH370. There's the book cover right there. Take us through this theory of suicide and why it's often been discounted in the past.
So this was a program in Australia. It brought together experts, including the former head of the ATSB, their investigative body, for the first time. And the conclusion was that it was the captain, Captain Zahari Shah, who did bring down the plane, or at least he took command, he turned off all the navigation aids, he turned off the radar, he then flew round Indonesia down into the Southern Ocean. The problem with the program is it told us nothing we didn't already know. This theory that the captain did it has been around since day one, and this program didn't really advance the argument as to the evidence that proves it. Wolf, I promise you there is not a single shred of new evidence as to what happened to that plane. There's lots of extrapolation, there is lots of conclusions and people thinking that if you take one and one it must equal two. But was it nefarious? Was it mechanical? Was it something else? We still do not know. Having said that, they were the experts and they did a good job at actually, if you like, reappraising the evidence.
Richard Quest, with the very latest on that front, the mystery clearly continues. Thanks very, very much. Other news we're following. The First Lady of the United States, Melania Trump, expected to spend several more days in the hospital after a procedure to treat a benign kidney condition. But now there are some questions about the length of her hospital. The president did offer this upbeat assessment just a little while ago.
I want to start by saying that Melania is in the hospital, doing really well. She's watching us right now. And I want to thank the incredible doctors, Walter Reed Medical Center. They did a fantastic job. So thank you, and she sends her love.
Let's bring in our chief medical correspondent, Dr. Sanjay Gupta. Sanjay, tell us about this embolization procedure on her kidney and what kind of hospital stay this kind of procedure would normally involve.
Yeah, sure. Well, this is a procedure as opposed to a surgery where you're actually making an incision and examining the kidney in this case directly. With this, it's sort of like a large IV, if you will, in one of the blood vessels, and a catheter is put through that blood vessel and threaded up to the area around the kidney and around this abnormality specifically. And then a type of glue substance, something that basically blocks the blood vessels, is injected to basically eliminate any more blood flow to this area that's abnormal. You want that area to not receive blood flow, and eventually it causes it to wither away. Or if it's at risk of bleeding in some way, it'll really decrease that risk of bleeding. That's what the procedure is, an embolization procedure. They do this in various parts of the body, in this case on the kidney. Typically, to the second part of your question, someone could go have this procedure done in the morning and go home the same day, an outpatient procedure, as it's called. If they're more worried than staying overnight to see if somebody might develop pain or some other problem, to basically try and control that, but not the entire week. That's not typical. We looked at data. We talked to several doctors who performed this sort of procedure. That's just not typical.
So what does that say to you?
Well, I don't know, Wolf. I think anything really is sort of speculation. You always wonder, look, is there something more going on here? Is this an abundance of caution in some way? I mean, obviously, this is the First Lady, so is this situation being treated differently for some reason? From a medical standpoint, what the questions I would ask is, what was it exactly that was being embolized? And why has that raised a greater level of concern based on the number of days she needs to be in the hospital? Could it mean that the embolization was the first procedure out of another procedure still to come? Sometimes you will embolize something to basically make it less likely to bleed when it is subsequently operated upon. But again, Wolf, it's we don't know. There was a very short statement from the First Lady's office telling us that she had that procedure yesterday. And then another statement today basically saying that she's resting comfortably and we would likely not hear anything more.
And the president tweeted just a little while ago, our great First Lady is doing really well. We'll be leaving hospital in 2 or 3 days. Thank you for so much love and support. And I think I speak for all of us yes. here at CNN, all of our viewers here in the U.S. and around the world. We wish her a speedy recovery from this procedure. Sanjay, thanks very much.
You got a Wolf. Thank you.
Michael Flynn, he pled guilty to lying to the FBI and is cooperating with Robert Mueller's special investigation. Now the disgraced former national security advisor to President Trump is praising his former boss in a brand new book. So how could that impact? Could it impact in a new book? Flynn wrote the foreword to this book. The book is entitled America First, the Make America Great Manifesto. Flynn said this in the foreword, quote, we must support the mission by electing the Congress that President Trump requires to further enact his vision for our country. The midterm election is only a few months off. It's time we put possible Make America Great Again candidates through their paces, choose those we can strongly support, and do whatever we can to get out the vote this November, close quote. Let's bring in our legal analyst, former federal prosecutor Laura Coates. Is it remarkable at all, unusual, that someone who's now awaiting sentencing, he's already pleaded guilty to these charges, would come out and say these nice things about the president of the United States?
It's both remarkable and surprising that he would do so. Not that he preserves some loyalty to the president and the mission that he initially signed on to on the campaign, but that in the position he's in right now as a cooperator, remember, he's not just somebody who's pled guilty, he is a known cooperator of the Mueller probe, whose job it is and is to figure out whether anyone who is a part of the Trump campaign had any collusive engagement with Russian nationals or foreign nationals like Russia. And so it seems to me it's quite a signal to the administration and Donald Trump that there is no love lost in spite of a cooperator's agreement. But it also kind of begs the question as to why he takes such a prominent and vocal role, knowing that just a few weeks ago, Mueller said, we want to delay the sentencing. The reason that's important, Wolf, is because when you are a cooperator in a federal investigation, oftentimes they will hang that carrot and dangle it. And the more you cooperate and the more that your evidence and reporting and everything you're going to give them is assisting them or beneficial, and they will put off the actual recommendation for the Senate. It may be much more lenient if you're cooperative enough. And so that they're dangling this now in front of him 2 months out and this comes out is pretty surprising. I will note that it was written, though, I think back in March before the request was made for that to be a delay in sentencing, but it's quite remarkable.
He's also out there campaigning for certain mm-hmm. candidates publicly. Is that unusual for someone who's awaiting sentencing in a case like this?
Absolutely. I mean, he's pled guilty in a case that involves, at its core, election-related matters and interference. I'm not sure who would like him to be somebody who is jockeying for them or championing for them. The credibility is always an issue, especially if somebody who has been charged and admitted to lying. I'm not sure why you'd have them on your actual platform to talk about you. But other things have happened in this administration. And certainly the push towards the midterm elections is compelling otherwise odd behavior to become more normalized. And you're seeing that here.
Some have raised the possibility of a presidential pardon. And maybe he's shopping for a presidential pardon. He's already pled guilty.
He has, but he hasn't been sentenced. Now remember, the presidential pardon power could have even extended before he was even charged. Remember, Sheriff Joe Arpaio wasn't yet sentenced when he was pardoned by the president. You're not seeing that here. The primary difference being one was a cooperator in the Mueller probe and one is not. And it's not very known at this point in time to what extent and what information Michael Flynn has provided that may entice the president to give that extreme supportive loyalty.
I assume by now he's already told the special counsel everything he knows. This has been going on for months mm-hmm. and months. Or you think they're going back to him all the time saying we need more answers?
There may be the bulk of his testimony already given, but there's corroboration. As every statement is made and you see from the different legal teams representing President Trump, there's new questions that are being raised that go back to a point in time that Michael Flynn may have been knowledgeable. And so the more statements that come out, the more there is a need for corroboration. And by the way, remember, Mueller is strategic, and every prosecutor would be, to delay sentencing. That is essentially keeping the person on the line longer, and there's got to be a reason, and it's not gratuitous.
Interesting development, Laura Coates. Mm-hmm. Thanks, as usual, for joining us. Just days before Meghan Markle is to marry Prince Harry, there's still some uncertainty.